There are now more than over 17,000 confirmed cases of coronavirus across the continent, with a number of African countries imposing a range of prevention and containment measures against the spread. According to the latest data by the Johns Hopkins University and Africa Center for Disease Control and COVID-19 in Africa, the breakdown remains fluid as countries confirm cases as and when. The whole of Africa is rising cases, with only two countries holding out as of April. Joining us in the studio is a data analyst, Charles Edosonwa, to take a look at some of these data coming at us from around the globe, specifically in Africa. Thank you very much for joining us on the news. All right, let's start with what are the latest figures as we know it, and of what relevance are they?
Across Africa is about 17,212. The death rate is still about 5.2%, which is about 900, but the recovery is about 35,000 persons have recovered. But then if you look at the different countries and the spread, I mean, there are about 47 countries now being infected, right? A couple of them are above the 100 mark. It's about 16 countries above the 100 mark, about 14 countries is between 20 cases and 100. And about 15 cases less than 20. 15 countries less than 20 cases, yes. So if you look at that and put it into perspective, you would then understand who is really spreading the most. However, about 5 or 7 countries constitute about 50% of the total cases in Africa, and that is South Africa, Algeria, and Cameroon. Sorry, 3. South Africa, Algeria, and Cameroon constitutes 50% of the total cases in Africa. So I think, I mean, we need to start looking at those data and saying, hey, what are these countries doing presently or currently, and how come they are having about 50% of the entire cases and 71% of the entire deaths across Africa? Yes.
There are some that would say they worry about the real importance of having these figures churned out on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. Some say it amplifies the fear among people. And there are those who say it is necessary if we have to combat this. What's your position on the relevance of data at this time?
Data is very, very relevant at any time. Now more than ever, we need a whole lot of data because we need to see the spread. We need to juxtapose those data with different things. We need to put those data in perspective. So we need to match those data with healthcare. We need to match those data with when did these countries shut down their borders. We need to look at all of these figures to understand why is this spread evident in some other countries. And I mean, there have been a lot of myths. Whether Africans are more resistant to it, which I don't necessarily think so. But we really need to understand the data, and I think that's what everyone around the world is basically trying to look at now and trying to understand, yes.
Okay, one of the key concerns about this virus, especially here in Nigeria, I'm sure in some other African countries as well, is the way the palliatives are being distributed. That is a key concern. How can data help us better manage this? And do we even have that kind of data that will be effective in the issue of palliative distribution?
Okay, so I'll take it from the last question. Do we have the relevant data? No. So unfortunately, we've not been collecting a whole lot of data, both as a country or as an organization, as a community. So for example, I want to distribute palliatives around Lagos. How do I know the regions around Lagos that have the most need for it, right? Am I going to come and distribute those palliatives in Ikoyi and Lekki, or am I going to go to Ikorodu or Abulegba or something? Yes. So because we do not have those amount of data now, or where some of these persons are, we've not been collecting all of this data. So we're currently just collecting those data now. We're in partnership with the Lagos State Volunteer Corps, and we're getting a whole lot of persons registered, and even helping to go into these communities and collecting data within these communities, yes.
Okay, so how soon do you think such data, I mean, the data that you're collecting now will be able to help? I mean, time is of the essence at this point. So are you beginning to use those data, or you're still working at collating it?
Yes, so we're beginning to use those data, especially with respect to the distribution of the palliative. So any amount of data we find now is relevant. So for example, telco data, and you saw some of the persons at the federal level saying, hey, you know what, the palliatives we're sending out is for persons who have been recharging less than 100 naira a month. Right. So we are beginning to use some of those data that we had before, partnering with the private sector to be able to get the right data to say, oh, these are the persons that we should distribute to. Because again, data does not lie. You can't tell us, oh, I need the food and you've been recharging less. You have less than more than 200,000 or 300,000 in your account. And so
how does that really work? Because there are those who have said this issue of data is something that can be solved if data analysts like yourself would find a way to get to telecom, almost even the person in the suburb, even though they don't have access to the internet, they have a mobile phone that can receive and, you know, send messages. So why is that gold mine not being harnessed?
The structure. We don't have those structures currently put in place before now. So it's very difficult. We are just reacting now. It's very difficult to actually collect the right amount of data now because you're reacting to pressure from the security operators, you're reacting to pressure from a whole lot of other factors. So it's very, very difficult to start making relevant deductions from those data. However, the simple ones you can get, like I said, your data from your bank account, your data from your mobile phone, we can use those data to say, hey, okay, you know what, this is what we can do. I mean, the private sector has been using this data. The small loan companies have been using the amount of data you recharge on your phone to determine the kind of loan that will be given to you. So people have been using this data. The government has just not used it. So now we have seen that need to say, hey, you know what, we need to be able to get some of this data from private sector. And mind you, the partnership with the private sector is not necessarily cash sometimes. Sometimes it's really just opening up your database with the right control, with the right measures in place, and giving government your support. If you see what the Alibaba Group did, they opened their cloud computing platform for the healthcare sector, so that they can process a lot of data, analyze a lot of data at the same time. And just 200 million people. To process all of this data, you need some massive data storage capacity. You need some massive cloud computing capacity. And we need the private sector to partner with us on things like this.
Okay, what worries me is that most of these data computation you talk about seems to happen in urban areas like Lagos, the FCT, Enugu, and the likes. What about massive locations with loads of people, undocumented, little access to the internet? Aside these hot spots of Lagos, the FCT, Enugu, and Kano and Kaduna and the likes, what about other areas? How do you propose, now going forward, based on what we know now with this COVID-19, to ensure that everybody gets some sort of capture, some sort of way that we can identify them?
So I think, I mean, if I were to do it, I would go the stakeholder management route. So go to those communities, right? What have we been using our local government structures for? So the local government structure by now should be able to help us reach those interior communities. That's the reason why we have a local government structure. So you should then be able to empower them and get the right data entry platform and let them even understand it and know why they are collecting this data. It can be, and again, for you to collect data, sometimes you need to be able to support the community. So for example, you want to collect data from the farmers in the Olo Southwest, try and subsidize fertilizers for them and tell them to register. And by the time you're giving them fertilizers, you have their data. You can keep talking to them. That's what it is. So for some of these interior communities, we need to use the government structures. We need to use the local government structures. We need to use the state government structures. We need to use the ward, the councilor structures, the community structures, the religious structures we have. I mean, the persons you're trying to capture, they are not in space. Okay. They're part of a community, a church. Right? I mean, just...
It's very doable if
very,
we have the will.
Very, very doable, yes.
Okay, so... some would say that, yes, we've had a lot of challenges. COVID-19 has disrupted lives and all of that. But in terms of data collection and management, do you think that this COVID-19 period might be like a gold mine when it comes to, you know, ensuring, I mean, beginning the process of having valuable data for the country.
Yes, and I think this is not just Nigeria, right? This is global. For example,
but we are somewhere behind when it comes to that.
Yes, but we have to start. So, for example, I never knew Nigeria had NCDC. Do you understand? I mean, I'm saying that now, but I never knew that, right? Okay. Up until now. But they have been existing and they have been running. And they are really showing a whole lot of capacity now. They are taking a lot of data. They are updating people as fast as possible. I mean, they have been very, very efficient now. And yes, moving forward, we need to really partner with the private sector. Because again, you also need to look at, in data collection, what is a workable model? You can't say, I just want to be the government and start collecting data. It's going to be very difficult. So sometimes you need to partner with private sector. The countries that have it sorted out, most of those data come from either the private sector or when people are registering for one or two things or the other. And that's basically what it is.
You were speaking and I just had a thought about the issue of privacy, because sometimes people are hesitant to put their name in databases. There was, I think, just before the before the lockdown, there was a website that offered free hand sanitizers and face masks, and they asked for, I knew that was a way to collect information, but the information that they were asking for were not something that, you know, is so secret, so to say. But there are those who have real hesitation about privacy. How will you allay fears when it comes to, you know, in the process of collecting data, you breach people's privacy and use that data for something else?
So data would always be breached unless the government can step in. So the government needs to, so there are a couple of regulations around the world that we can use their data protection model and incorporate that into Nigeria. We just need to sign up for those, and the government is saying, hey, you know what, for everybody collecting data, this is the rule of engagement with respect to the data that you're collecting. And that's basically just what it is.
Yes. Thank you very much, Charles, for joining us on the news.